Hello and most welcome to all our viewers and friends. Good afternoon to you all. You all know that we are currently going through the pandemic period, and hence we are under a situation of limited lockdown. And during this period, our science center are not allowed to directly host the visitors and viewers who normally hosts into our centers every day. So currently our approach is to reach everyone during this pandemic period with the messages of science from various fields. And in doing so, we created one series called First Hand, in which we talk to the scientists and stalwarts of different fields who are making pioneering contributions, not only in our country, but also at the international forum and level. And our approach is to connect them to people. Our intention is to learn and let everybody know what are the cutting edge fields in which the scientists from our country are making significant contributions towards the welfare of mankind. And today, I'm not only extremely privileged, but also very much proud to have our guest, one of the leading chemists and scientists of our country, Dr. Amit Bhattacharya. And I'll tell you why I'm so proud about it, because in all such occasions, we normally get scientists who are making significant contributions in their field. But here we have today one scientist who is a very close friend to me, and who is actually a classmate for me. We both shared the same initial periods, same formative age together in the same school. And now that he has been into this level, it's an extreme proud moment for me to introduce him. And I'll just give a brief introduction to Dr. Amit Bhattacharya. And before that, though we personally talk in a different term, but let us be a little formal here. So welcome, Dr. Bhattacharya, to our online channel, rscpcalicut.virtual. This is actually the online platform of our science center, through which we try to reach out to the general people to make them aware about the scientific fields and creating a general awareness of science among the masses. So thank you very much for accepting our invitation and joining us at this moment. Dr. Bhattacharya is joining us from his institution. I'll give a brief introduction to Dr. Bhattacharya. During his doctoral studies, he was associated to the famous Shaha Institute of Nuclear Physics, named after Professor Meghnad Shaha. And now he is a principal scientist of the Central Salt and Marine Chemicals Research Institute, Bhavnagar, Gujarat. And his research orientation has been water purification and membranes in particular. I have my personal attachment and interest towards the water purification field, in fact, because in one of my previous incarnations, I was working as a curator and scientist in National Science Center, Delhi. And there we had to make one public gallery concerning the water and the concept of water. And while doing so, we researched significantly into the procedures of purification, into the conditions of water distribution in our country. And I personally have seen that for some people, while the water scarcity, the idea of water scarcity doesn't exist at all, for some people, it is a very, very stark reality of life. I've seen even within the confines of Delhi, there are regions where people get 750 liters of water usage per day, that they are privileged to have that, while in other areas like Sanjay Colony, even 50 liters is a very fortunate gift to people. So, and there is another very interesting point that we understood at that time when we inquired among the people, what is the general idea of water? Where do we get our water from? Most of the cases we understood that people say that we get it from the tap, we get it from the local tube well, we get it from the local water pump, but distribution tank. But in most of the cases, we really do not know what is deep down the real source of the water. No city, no civilized modern city can in fact live on the groundwater because the requirement is so much and so intensified. And water harnessing is quite an important issue because every day in everything, we not only use water directly for our direct purposes, but whatever we make, even the shirt we make requires huge amount of water. The shoe we wear requires a huge amount of water. Each kilogram of rice for production demands an astronomical figure of water requirement it has got. So it's not easy to supply the water in general for all the purposes. And that is why the groundwater recharging takes a very long time. So that is why the rate of withdrawal is much faster than the rate of replenishment for the groundwater. And that is why we have to depend upon definitely on the surface water. We have to harness water from the river. And I had a personal experience that in Yamuna, from where Delhi used to get its water to a significant region of Delhi, Yamuna, while it was flowing from the Nizamuddin Bridge, it is so much full of sewage that there's hardly anything of the original water. And so much of water is withdrawn from our rivers that we are killing the rivers, we are polluting the rivers, we are making the surface water very scarce and rare for us. And hence the huge importance of scientists like Dr. Amit Bhattacharya, who are our water warriors, who are trying to reclaim the water from its used form, reclaim the water from its unusable form like salinated water, and they are continuously developing technologies which makes it possible. Personally speaking, Dr. Bhattacharya has produced 96 research papers. He has contributed in several book chapters. He is a very active enthusiast regarding popularization of scientific ideas. So he has written books in Bengali and in English. He has been a visiting professor to universities in India, universities in UK. He is a part of several research projects that are funded by national and international agencies like DBT India, DST India, of course CSIR and IFS Sweden, several others. And not only that, he has been a recipient of innumerable awards for his contributions to this field. But I'll not stand between you and Dr. Bhattacharya anymore. So, Dr. Bhattacharya, the stage is all yours for your presentation, the water purification technology and membranes in particular.
Thanks for your introduction, Manoj. This is... Thanks for introduction, Dr. Manoj. Now I am just giving you the brief idea regarding membranes, the trend in water purification. Whatever I have quoted actually in my first slide, this is regarding one theme publications I have made regarding all CSIR activities regarding safe water. Whatever institute are doing in particular water aspect, that I have theme publications, I have made these particular publications in 2017. This is left hand side, CSIR strives towards safe water for all. All the particular CSIR institute who are dealing with water activities, that I have as an example in particular theme.
regarding these particular whatever technology, water purification, and whatever we are facing regarding these pandemic situations. Now I can connect in this particular forum through technology also. That's why just in water aspects I have written, future says struggle for me, forget everything. That means you have to struggle for water. Future is like that. And technology says, believe me, I am the direction. Only technology can solve the particular whatever problem is regarding water purification. Only technology can just deliver you regarding safe water. And this is related to my next slide, please. This is related to our institute regarding this particular CSMCRI, that is Central Salt and Marine Chemicals Research Institute, and earlier it was known as Central Salt Research Institute. That time aim was that to be the leader in salt production in the world. Now it has just opened different branches with time, and these are the branches I have just mentioned, that is salt and marine chemicals, membrane science and separation technology, natural products and green chemistry, inorganic materials and catalysis, process design and engineering, plant omics and applied phycology and biotechnology, analytical and environmental science and division and centralized facility, CSIR, Mars Mandapam camp is also there, that is the field station. And here I have just given regarding 1954 pictures and these particular 2020 pictures. These are the 1954 Jawaharlal Nehru founded 10th April, that is our foundation day for CSMCRI. And now it has just opened its branch, different branch regarding that whatever you are seeing, just particular that particular building is there, that is called heritage building, and another 2-3 buildings are also there just for opening different branches. Next slide, please.
Next.
This is the motivation actually regarding membrane separation. Membrane separation techniques of theoretical interest to multi-billion currency industry covering a vast spectrum of applications. Just I want to portray just in one slide. These are the different activities as well as structures in our particular membrane science and separation technology. Just I am giving you the glimpse. Left hand side corner, it is membrane preparation facility that regarding thin film composite membranes that I will say afterwards. And these are the particular membranes, whatever left hand side bottom you are seeing. And these particular below the particular membranes, you are seeing module of membranes, that is indigenous modules prepared in our lab. And that particular module facility arrangement is also there. And you are seeing regarding this plant of demo plant is also there. And this is hollow fiber unit and hollow fiber arrangement, and these are the EDI, electrode ionization arrangement. And right hand side you are seeing, this is the mobile RO van, and we have just whatever our societal mission is, every calamity we are taking this particular bus to different locations. I have taken once to the particular Ayla victims, for Ayla victims in Sundarban, regarding these particular mobile RO van I have taken from this Bhavnagar to West Bengal. Whatever picture you are seeing, that is in Sundarban area. Next slide, please. These are the market potentials regarding membrane processes. These I have quoted from different magazine. The demand for global membrane processes is estimated to increase at a compound annual growth rate 9.3% from 2014 to 2019, driving the membranes market to $29.31 billion. The Asian Pacific and North American regions dominated the membranes market in 2013 and accounted 66.1% of the market share. Due to the increasing water and wastewater treatment, whatever Dr. Manas has told you regarding water and water wastewater treatment, we are whatever we can do in our particular daily life, we can save water as well as water purification, that is different aspects, and I will cover in different lecture. Pharmaceuticals, medical uses, and industrial gas processing projects in the Asia Pacific region, especially in India, Australia, and China. The emerging regions are expected to register maximum growth, and also high growth will be seen in the Middle East and Africa. These are the market potentials I am quoting from that markets and markets particular magazine regarding membrane market. Next slide, please. Now I'm just taking into my world regarding membranes. What is membranes? Membranes definition is like this. Membrane is a physical barrier made up of solid and liquid, which separates two different distinct phases and plays the vital role to act as selective barrier to allow the transportation of substances through it under the influence of some driving forces. This is important regarding the particular membrane separation processes. All membrane separation processes should be just one force is required. Regarding whatever you have just acquainted in particular osmosis, that is concentration driven process. I will come after this, and after that these RO and whatever you are just acquainted, that is also some driving force is needed, that is pressure driven phenomena. Just I will come after this. This is the common example of membranes, whatever we are acquainted regarding skin as well as this particular kidney. I am just portrayed regarding skin. These are the skin layers, and skin layers are also multi layers, and whatever you are seeing, that is complicated one, and hair shaft, oil gland, epidermis layer, dermis layer, subcutaneous tissue, everything is there. This is complicated, and we will translate into particular whatever we are discussing today regarding thin film composite membranes. That is the at present this is the best one whatever we have acquainted in membrane systems. Okay, next slide. This is the membrane separation. Just I am uttering the history of membrane separation. You are acquainted with Abbe Nolle, that is 1748. He first coined the term of osmosis, and after that Van Thuff, 1887, just osmotic law. You are acquainted, all of you are acquainted with particular pi equals to CRT equations, and Graham is dialysis. Graham's dialysis phenomena, everybody knows. And here I have portrayed this 1901, Van Thuff received the first Nobel Prize for osmotic law. And after that, nobody is there just to share the Nobel Prize in regarding membrane separation. Whatever I have told regarding membrane market potential or something like that, I will come after this. And Shodi Rajan, Dr. Shodi Rajan was one of the pioneers in particular membrane separation industry or whatever may be, in terms of desalination, in terms of whatever these particular techniques. These are the history regarding microfiltration, ultrafiltration, hemodialysis, electrodialysis, reverse osmosis, and ultrafiltration. Regarding it started from 1920 to 1960, you are just seeing that particular name. 1960, it has started its avenue regarding seawater desalination. That's the pioneer work Dr. Shauri Rajan has done. And after that, just we will come after this. Why we are taking these membrane separations? This is environment friendly, appreciable energy savings, greater flexibility and in designing systems, and low maintenance cost. Next slide, please. Here, this is the picture of Dr. Shauri Rajan, 1962. He has, whatever I have told regarding seawater desalination, he is the pioneer, and he has invented this particular cellulose acetate membranes. And after that, so many membranes have come, synthetic membranes have come. We will discuss in synthetic membrane aspect, but Dr. Shauri Rajan is pioneer in regarding seawater desalination. He has the worked on various things of cellulose acetate membranes. That's the beauty of cellulose acetate membranes, is different from whatever we are we will discuss afterwards regarding thin film composites. Osmosis and reverse osmosis, that is regulator of life. You know, osmosis is a particular fundamental aspects of many biological systems, that is the cause of life. And reverse osmosis, you are acquainted in our particular daily life, as well as whatever you are acquainted in purification, supply, water supply. Reverse osmosis, the way of life. In every aspects, we are accustomed with reverse osmosis. Reverse osmosis, whatever I am mentioning, not reverse osmosis, it is osmosis reverse. That means so many processes can cover that I will afterwards I will discuss. This I am portraying regarding this chemical potential driven process, that is osmosis and reverse osmosis. Whatever you are seeing, just osmosis in my top picture, that is osmosis is showing, that is concentration driven. And this reverse osmosis below this particular membranes picture, that is reverse osmosis, that is pressure driven phenomena. But after all the particular osmosis and reverse osmosis, that is chemical potential driven phenomena. Next slide, please. Whatever I have told you regarding the driving forces, these four driving forces are the main driving forces regarding these membrane processes: pressure, electrical, concentration, thermal. Pressure driven phenomena is microfiltration, ultrafiltration, nanofiltration, reverse osmosis, pervaporation. And these electrical phenomena means coupled with concentration, that is electrodialysis and electroosmosis. And concentration phenomena is a concentration driven process is osmosis and dialysis. And whatever you are seeing, concentration and thermal driven thermal coupling processes are thermoosmosis. Whatever I have told in our in the particular previous slide, all these left hand side, microfiltration, ultrafiltration, nanofiltration, reverse osmosis, all are reverse osmosis processes. Whatever we are just acquainted in particular system, whatever in AquaGuard or whatever may be, that may be ultrafiltration system or microfiltration system, but all are reverse osmosis. It depends upon the porosity on charge of membranes. but all are basically reverse osmosis. That means osmosis direction is reversed in all the processes. Next slide, please. This is the separation range, just whatever I have told regarding macro filtration and ultra filtration, nano filtration, and reverse osmosis. You are seeing micro filtration is suitable for macromolecule separations, and ultra filtration is suitable for macromolecules as well as large molecules. And for molecular separation, nano filtration is suitable, and reverse osmosis is for ion separations. Whatever I have told regarding seawater desalination, that is required reverse osmosis. And next, below this particular range, you are seeing these are the sizes I have portrayed, from bacteria to ions that I have covered: conventional filtration, microfiltration, ultrafiltration, nanofiltration, and reverse osmosis. The size of the particular ions or molecules is decreasing. That means its pore size are reduced. Next slide. Portrayed in different way. Microfiltration, that is 100 nanometer to 1 micrometer. Ultrafiltration, 10 nanometer to 100 nanometer. Nanofiltration, 2 to 10 nanometer. RO is less than 1 nanometer. And these are the common solutes you can separate by this microfiltration, ultrafiltration, nanofiltration, reverse osmosis. Just see this reverse osmosis. It is written aqueous salt metal ions on monovalent salts. And whatever you are seeing from top to bottom, the sizes of the solutes are reducing. That means you are reducing your pore size of the membranes, and driven by particular phenomena of this pressure. All are related to pressure-driven process. Next slide. These are the membrane materials, common membrane materials. I have just regarding the structure of the membrane materials I have quoted. And this is cellulose acetate. Whatever I have told you just regarding Sodhi Rajan's work, all are related to cellulose acetate work. Cellulose acetate is unique in its function. In what aspect that is unique, I will tell you thin film composite membrane preparation. And this is the polysulfone right hand side, and polyether sulfone left hand side below the cellulose acetate. And polyamide is PI, that is below the polysulfone. And polyacrylonitrile PAN, it is written, and polyvinyl alcohol, that is PVA, polytetrafluoroethylene, PTFE, and PP, and polyvinyl, PP is polypropylene, and polyvinylidene difluoride. These are the common membrane materials, that is polymeric materials. Apart from these, you can use ceramic membranes also. That is a different chemistry is there. We are not discussing that particular aspects here. All I am discussing regarding membrane materials, regarding polymers. Okay, next slide. This is modifications of different polymers. Whatever I have sketched in my previous slides, that is parent or virgin polymer, you can modify that particular polymer according to your choice, according to your requirement. That is sulfonated polysulfone. Earlier I have shown only polysulfone. If you sulfonate it, then it will be polysulfone, sulfonated polysulfone. And this, if you carboxylate it, then it will be carboxylated polysulfone or polyphenylene oxide and polyvinyl alcohol based composite membranes that is also required in for particular desalination applications. I have just written in different separation performances, rejection in terms of 80% salt rejection regarding sulfonated polysulfones, carboxylated polysulfones, that is 93%. Maximum, whatever literature shows, that I have just mentioned. Polyvinyl alcohol-based membranes, that is 95%, and this is regarding 0.35% sodium chloride. All are related to different sodium chloride concentrations. That means from brackish water applications to seawater applications, you can choose your particular membranes according to your requirement. Next slide. These are the texture of particular membranes. Whatever we are dealing with membranes regarding many applications, but in terms of this particular morphology or whatever may be texture, I am just giving you the idea. This is divided is symmetrical membranes and anisotropic membranes. Symmetrical means from top to bottom the morphology is same. That is left hand side corner is isotropic microporous membranes. That means from top to bottom it is uniform and this is microporous. And after that non-porous dense, that means from top to bottom it is non-porous. And this is electrically charged membranes, means all top to bottom, that is chair from top to bottom functionality is there. If it is carboxylate, that means it will be COO minus. If it is sulfonate, then it will be SO3 minus, something like that. And beauty is like that in anisotropic membranes. Just see from below left hand side picture. This is called Loeb Soridajan anisotropic membranes. From top to bottom, the morphology is different. That means different module or different content morphology means density is different from it. It is called polymeric rich and as well as polymeric poor phase. Just see from top to bottom, it is polymeric rich phase. And from below portion, it is polymeric poor phase. That means it is porous membranes. It is called anisotropic membranes or asymmetric membranes. And after this, thin film composite anisotropic membranes, what we will focus today, these particular membranes, that is top portion is dense, and after this, just hollow or whatever may be, asymmetric structure is there. That is the beauty of thin film composite anisotropic membranes. And this is the supported liquid membranes. We are not discussing today, but liquid membranes are also giving good results in particular applications. Anyway, next slide. These I will focus today regarding thin newer generation reverse osmosis membranes such as thin film composite membranes. This is highly improved flux and salt rejection capabilities, and it is capable of rejecting organics. What it is, just I am coming back to that. Next slide. This is whatever I have told you regarding asymmetric membranes. Just see, this is the scanning electron microscopy picture. From top to bottom, that is morphology is different. From top you are seeing just one thin dense layer, and after that hollow or asymmetric structure is coming. This is called asymmetric membrane. This is casted by simple solution cast gelation. I will just give you the idea regarding this dust gelation after this. And this is broad pore size distribution, needs the right solvent and non-solvent system for preparation of this type of porosity, and this indirect pore size determination in terms of molecular weight cutoff. Molecular weight cutoff is a terminology regarding the characterization of membranes. Whatever molecular weight we are separating 90%, above 90%, that will be termed as molecular weight cutoff of the particular membranes. Next slide. This is just, see, whatever I have discussed earlier, microfiltration, that is pore size is more, and ultrafiltration, pore size is reducing, and this typical asymmetric membrane morphology, whatever you have seen earlier in previous slide, this is asymmetric membrane morphology from top to bottom, it is different, and this nanofiltration and reverse osmosis porosity is reducing. These are the simple morphology picture I have portrayed regarding pore size and process. Anyway, next slide. And this is the basic thing regarding asymmetric membrane preparation. First, we are taking regarding asymmetric membrane preparation, some fabric, that means polyester fabric generally we are taking. It is support, it is for support of this particular polymer, because engineering, if it is a fabric supported membranes, then you can mold in particular engineering shape, and it will not disturb the particular morphology, what you want to do, what you want to in particular in terms of whatever modification you want to do, you can do, and you can shape it in engineering fashion. That is why fabric support is required. And polymer is casted on particular fabric, and solution layer on fabric, just see top right hand portion. And after that, it is dipped into the non-solvent bath of that particular polymer. Here, suppose you are taking polysulfone. For polysulfone, one solvent is NN dimethyl formamide. That means polymer is dissolved in particular NN dimethyl formamide and casted in particular whatever you are seeing in glass plate or whatever, maybe machine casting also we are doing, and then dipped into the particular for polysulfone non-gelation gelation bath. That means for polysulfone, water is gelating agent. You are dipping into the whatever you have prepared in terms of cast, and it is dipped into the this particular water bath. Then this polymer will be rephase, that means solidifications. After in solution state, it will come to the solid state again. That means from top, you are transferring your polymeric solution to polymeric solid phase. That means it is phase inversion. Its terminology is phase inversion. And that I have just given you the idea regarding this water non-solvent mixture and this particular diffusive polymerization, diffusive diffusional exchange of water and non-solvent, water as a non-solvent and solvent that is coming, and this is called gelation bath. And next slide, please. This is the actual picture regarding this asymmetric membrane preparation. Just see, this is polymer in solution. That means whatever polymer you are taking, it will be in solution. Means suppose polysulfone is one of the best polymer regarding membrane preparation. This is engineering polymer. This is polymer polysulfone in dimethyl formamide you can take, and after that casting in membrane form and gelling in non-solvent bath. Means for polysulfone it is water. Water means water as non-solvent, and asymmetric membrane preparation is done. This is the simple arrangement. This is hand casting mechanism, hand casting process. I have shown polymer solution core here, that is casting and expanding and gelation into the water bath. And here I have just showing you regarding machine casting. Here polysulfone solution is poured here, and this micrometer or knife is there to control the thickness, and after that it will roll into the gelation bath, that is water. Here membrane will be formed, and this is called wet phase separation techniques. Why it is wet phase? Because it is water. Water is there for non-solvent for polysulfone. Next slide. After polysulfone membrane preparation, these particular membranes are rolled into metaphenylene diamine bath and trimethyl chloride bath. What I have just given you the idea regarding this particular thin film composite membranes, whatever I have uttered in this particular previous slide. Thin film polyamide composite. Thin film polyamide composite means it is three layer. I will come after this three layer composite, and one is polyester support, second one is this polysulfone, and over that polyamide is there. Polyamide means CONH bond formation in particular. Whatever compound is forming, we will polymerize in that way, so that CONH bond formation will occur. How it comes, this particular thin film composite membranes, it invented actually 1981. Cadot has pioneered in this particular thin film polyamide composite membranes. Maybe because of our skin is peptide bond, CONH bond formation is there. From there, he has the idea. Regarding if you just form whatever in what whatever the process is, if you can just form polyamide on the any support, it will reject desalination, it will reject whatever solutes and salt, whatever may be. That is why thin film polyamide composite membrane idea has come. And whatever I have just shown you regarding this polysulfone, after polysulfone membrane preparation, it is dipped into the metaphenylene diamine bath. Those who know metaphenylene diamine, this is benzene diamine 1,3 position amine is there, and this is after this trimethyl chloride 1,3 trimethyl chloride COCl is there in benzene functionality, and after that it is cured. And this thin film polyamide composite membrane prepared in this particular morphology. This is the morphology, top morphology. This is the cross section morphology I have shown you. Whatever you have seen my previous slide, this is asymmetric membranes, and this is top portion is just picture is like this. The polyamide morphology is appearing in onto the particular polysulfone support. Next slide. This is the actual picture, just whatever you are seeing. This is polyester fabric, and over that polysulfone is there, that you have seen that particular asymmetric membrane preparation, whatever I have shown, this polysulfone, how it is polysulfone membrane is prepared, and over that polyamide membrane or layer is just deposited. Polyamide membranes, it's the chemistry of these particular thin film polyamide composite membrane preparation, and this is the key reaction of these particular polyamide composite membranes. Just see this metaphenylendiamine in water and trimethyl chloride in hexane. This is actually two monomers in different phases. One is in aqueous phase, another is in hexane phase. Interfacial polymerization occurs just like nylon chemistry. If you are acquainted with particular nylon chemistry is also like this, just condensation reaction. This is also condensation reaction, CONH. Just see, CONH bond formation is there. That means your amine moiety and as well as acid chloride moiety will join and forms and polyamide structure. It is cross-linked structure and it is attached to the particular polysulfone support. That's the beauty of thin film polyamide composite. It can attach to polysulfone support. It will not detach from polysulfone support, and it is the rejecting layer of thin film polyamide composite membranes. Whatever you are accustomed in particular desalination or whatever maybe in terms of water purification, this is the thin film polyamide composite membrane are used. Whatever I have shown you, this is regarding the comparison. Polymer membranes, that is natural membrane, two types of membranes, natural membrane and synthetic membranes. Why we are shifting towards synthetic membranes? Natural membrane is poor chemical and thermal stability, and synthetic membrane is higher chemical stability, and as well as you can mold it any engineering shape you want, and that's the beauty. You can shape into module shape, and you can process large volume of water. Next slide. And this is the another interesting topic, just I have covered. This is right hand side. I have already told you this is metaphenylendiamine and trimethyl chloride, and interfacial polymerization occurs. And this is the three layer thin film polyamide composite. Polyester fabric is 100 micrometer, and over that polysulfone, it is 35/240 micrometer, and over that this polyamide structure is appearing. That is 1 nanometer, something like that. It needs skill to particular tune the thickness of the particular polyamide layer. Right hand side this membrane is called reverse osmosis membranes, and left hand side, just see, these membranes are different from these membranes. Here we are using different diamines. This is called aliphatic diamines, that is piperazine and trimethyl chloride is same, and interfacial polymerization occurs. This is the chemistry and interfacial polymerization. Whatever I have told, that polyamide is appearing on particular on polysulfone support. Just from right hand side and left hand side, why I have just portrayed in this type of same slide I have just portrayed in this is actually whatever you are seeing right hand side, that membrane is called reverse osmosis membranes. It can reject sodium chloride, sodium sulfate, whatever may be, all types of salts. But in terms of next left hand side membranes, This is called nanofiltration membranes. That is charged nanofiltration membranes. It has the capability of sulfate rejection over sodium chloride rejection. That means if you take sodium sulfate and sodium chloride mixture, it will separate sodium sulfate more compared to sodium chloride. That means monovalent will pass through, bivalent, that means sulfate will not pass through, sulfate will retain. That's the beauty of charged nanofiltration membranes. This is the market demand of this particular nanofiltration membranes nowadays. It's coming up because it can remove the hardness. That means sodium chloride, if your particular, whatever may be your in your water, if it is sodium sulfate is more, it can selective, it can have the ability to separate sodium sulfate compared to sodium chloride. That's the beauty. In industry also, you are accustomed in particular boiler or whatever may be, and that nanofiltration membrane is required to save the boiler life. What I have written in this particular slide, just see the reactions are less favorable towards the formation of interfacial polymerization of PIP and with TMC. The unreacted acyl chloride unit in TFC membrane would be more with PIP compared to metavalent. Just see, one I have just not mentioned. This is just whatever in terms of polyamide. Just see, this is left hand side COOH is there. That means in your trimethyl chloride, in this trimethyl chloride, COCl is there, 3-COCl is there, and sometimes COCl will be converted to COOH. That will give the ionic charge to the membranes. If you can produce COOH more, that will be charged membranes. And here it will be, it is also there. But in terms of nanofiltration membranes, whatever I am telling, COOH is more compared to this. That is why the particular, this is because of piperazine chemistry. Piperazine is aliphatic. I mean, these reaction, the reaction are less favorable towards the formation of interfacial polymerization. That is why I have preferred this nanofiltration membrane because of its uniqueness. Anyway, the charged, I have written, the charged carboxyl moiety is present in the PIP-based TFC membranes seem to be responsible for the rejection of bivalent counter ions. That means, whatever I have told, sodium sulfate and sodium chloride, if you take sodium chloride and sodium sulfate, it will separate sodium sulfate much more compared to sodium chloride. That's the beauty. Anyway, this is the publications, Journal of Membrane Science, it is published. Anyway, next slide. These are the factors by which you can control your chemistry and you can control your rejection ability as well as flux in particular membranes. This is concentration of reactants, means whatever I have told you regarding amine and trimethyl chloride, and partition coefficients of the reactants. That means partition coefficient of the particular amine, diamine, and as well as trimethyl chloride, reactivity ratio of the reactants, insolubility nature of the base membrane, the overall kinetics and diffusion rates of the reactants, cross-linking reaction ability of the particular monomers, post-reactions or treatments of the resulting film. These are the factors of the particular interfacial polymerization kinetics. Anyway, next slide. Probably we don't know. I think this is the platform I can utter this particular message to you regarding United Nations World Water Day. 22nd March 1993 it has started. 22nd March is celebrated as World Water Day, and we can it is our actually our responsibility to save water in this aspect, whatever their message, United Nations message regarding save water, as well as this water purification, everything, and that we can relay to others also. This is my one of the publications what I have just shown you regarding all the methods I have covered in this particular article. If you can go through, this is drinking water contamination and treatment techniques, all treatment techniques I have tried to cover it. Next slide. This is the filtration technique, whatever I have I want to just share one thing, but it is same thing. And Manush, I cannot show na this. This is one cell is there. I want to show this. Hello.
Yeah. We can see it.
This is whatever I am just portrayed in dead end filtration unit. This is the dead end filtration unit. Just see here, liquid is perpendicularly passed through the membranes. This is the membrane holder, just here. This is the membrane holder, and you can attach your membranes, whatever ultrafiltration membranes you want to cover. And this is the arrangement regarding this particular dead end filtration. That means here feed stream is perpendicularly passed through the membranes. This is called dead end filtration. That is why it is called dead end filtration. And here a steel body is also there. This is also just regarding dead end filtration unit. Next slide. This is another this is whatever physics or chemical engineering fellows are accustomed in particular flow dynamics or fluid dynamics, whatever may be, whatever I have shown you, this is a dead end filtration. Another unit is there, that is called cross flow filtration unit. Here it is portrayed as cross flow filtration unit. That means fluid flow is passing through the tangentially over to the over the membranes. Here I have just kept for your understanding, dead end filtration is arrow is perpendicular to this your membranes, and here it is tangentially passed through over the membrane. And these are the this is the below, this is the simple arrangement whatever we are installing plants in terms of different societal missions. These are the simple arrangement, feed source and pretreatment and pressure, and this is the membrane modules, and this is the permeate, that means low concentration what you want to achieve, and this is concentrated portion, that is rejecting portion, and that is passes through in different things. Anyway, next slide. This is the again just see this is regarding membrane process by typical ultrafiltration process. cross flow velocity and whatever may be. Just I have whatever I have told you regarding this cross flow velocity. Rejection, left hand side, just see, rejection is 0%. That means all are passing through. Rejection is partial. That means some will be rejecting or retaining. And rejection is 99%, means all will be rejecting. No, nothing will be come out through the membranes. And this is the, I think you can understand this regarding flux. That means, suppose volume, it is expressed as whatever, maybe GFD, that means gallon feet square per day, or in terms of liters, meter square per hour. This is the unit of flux, and rejection is termed as percentage wise. Anyway, next slide. This is the membrane we are preparing in terms of laboratory scale as well as large scale. This is large scale membrane preparation, whatever you are just seeing. This is left hand side. This is ultrafiltration membranes, and this is thin film polyamide composite membranes, and this is spiral wound membrane module, whatever I have told you regarding engineering shape. That membrane is rolled into the particular shape that is called membrane module. And this is the membrane engineering, whatever may be, some spacer is needed, and it is the art of this particular thin film polyamide composite membranes to spiral wound RO module section. And this is the flat shaped membrane module. This whatever we are preparing in particular flat sheet, this is called flat sheet membranes. These flat sheet membranes are arranged parallelly, and this particular frame as a flat sheet membrane module, you can just show. That means this is flat sheet membrane module, and this is spiral wound membrane module. These are the two engineering shapes in terms of membrane module. Next slide. Whatever Dr. Manas has told you regarding this particular in terms of water supply and everything, that increasing scarcity and the demand of fresh water sources stimulated the drive for alternative resources like ocean and wastewater. These are the applications regarding membrane separation science, desalination of seawater and brackish water, and wastewater reuse and recycling. Wastewater reuse, why we are opting for wastewater reuse and recycling? Mostly because of fresh water source are limited, and these techniques, membrane separation techniques, are cost effective, sustainable water source, and treated water can be used industrial and other processes. Next slide. This is the reverse osmosis membranes. Whatever I have told you regarding this thin film polyamide composite membranes, it has the capability of salt rejection. Why it is like this? Different transport models are there. I am not entering into particular mathematical portion of this particular transport models. Just I am mentioning this transport model. This is Kimura-Soumirajan model is there. Solution diffusion mechanism is there. Nash-Planck equation is there. I just want to cover it in few minutes. Kimura-Soumirajan, in terms of it is called as preferential sorption mechanism. Preferential sorption mechanism means suppose you are taking your membranes and whatever membranes, it is not only this whatever I have portrayed here in terms of thin film polyamide composite membranes. Soumirajan has derived this particular model in terms of cellulose acetate membranes. If you take some membranes and this particular whatever salt solution you are taking in terms of heat, that water will absorb onto the particular membranes. That is called preferential sorption theory. And water, if water is sorbed onto the particular polymers or membranes, it will preferentially separate. That means it will pass through the membranes compared to your salt solution. That is why these particular transport mechanisms or separation of electrolytes occur. And you are acquainted, those of you acquainted with the Nernst-Planck equation, that is, everything is covered up. That is convection and diffusion as well as electrical charge factor, all are coupled in particular equation. That phenomena is occurring here in terms of thin film polyamide composite or whatever might be desalination membranes. This I have published in long back regarding this transport mechanism and separation of electrolytes. If you just want to cover it, just review in chemical engineering, just that's why I have covered. Next slide. And this is another applications. I am more comfortable with these particular systems regarding desalination as well as organic pollutant separations. These are the pesticides I have covered in my laboratory research. This is mostly herbicides. This is atrazine, simazine, diuron, isoproteron. You are accustomed with this particular whatever may be in terms of applications in agriculture. And these are the pentachlorophenol, 4-chlorophenol, 2-chlorophenol, hexaconazole, quatacol, and resorcinol. All are used in terms of these pesticides or whatever may be in terms of applications. They are coming into the water system and it will become toxic in terms of water. That is why thin film polyamide composite membranes can have the ability to separate these organic pollutants into satisfactory manner. That I have explored these findings. Slowly I will just tell some data. Next slide. These are the factors regarding organics removal. Earlier I have told you regarding your desalination things. Desalination mainly depends on if you can take your membranes charged one, that will separate sodium chloride or sodium sulfate, whatever salt is there, it can separate. But in terms of organics, chemistry is something different. If you you should be in that particular expertise so that you can tune your membrane properties in that manner, whatever you want to separate in terms of organics. These are the factors. Nature of membranes, that means pores, porosity, charge of the membranes, salt separation ability of the membranes, and these are the nature of organics, that means whatever you want to separate. What is the size of the particular organics, whether it is hydrophobic or hydrophilic, or polarity or dipole moment is also a factor. And another factor is nature of the water matrix, that means pH. Mainly pH. If you your particular feed pH you can change, your separation of the particular membranes will be different. And additives, if you some chemicals you can add, that will also influence the rejection ability of the membranes. These I have covered in separation and purification reviews. This was one of the good review I have written in terms of these particular separations and purification in terms of organic separation. Anyway, the next slide. This regarding separation of diuron and this isoproteron I have covered. these whatever you are acquainted with, now you are acquainted with particular system, that is thin film polyamide composite membranes. That means that it is three layer composite membranes. Three layer polyamide composite membranes means one is every, that is support, another is polysulfur, and another is polyamide. That membrane I have prepared and separates these particular diuron and isoproteuron in satisfactory manner. See the particular performances of this diuron separation. This flux is 30, around 30 LMH. This I have told you, flux is measured as LMH unit, liter meter square per hour. This unit, that is 30 LMH unit, and this is the flux. This is the rejection. Red one is the rejection. That is above 90%. It is showing. Time duration regarding 1 to 12 hour duration, this is almost same in terms of rejection as well as in terms of flux. That means another, I have not covered in that particular fashion, these membrane have the limitations in terms of fouling. That is why long time testing is required. What it is, fouling means any spontaneous movement, whatever flux, whatever rejection you are initially achieving, it may not be the same after some duration. What for? That is any particular molecules or any particular organics can attach onto the particular membranes, whatever you are taking. That is why your spontaneous movements or your spontaneous performances of the particular membranes are hindered. That is called fouling. That is why long time duration study is important. I have just here, I have in laboratory scale 12 hours study I have done. This is also regarding same thing, isoproteuron. For isoproteuron, flux and rejection, just see 30, nearly 30, above 30 maybe, 32 or something like that. And this is the rejection is above 90%. Anyway, next slide. This is regarding performances of diuron and isoproteuron. In whatever I have told you regarding the factors, if you change your membrane chemistry, that will separate different manner. That means your rejection profile will be different. Suppose whatever I have told you regarding this interfacial polymerization, this is the conventional one, water and hexane phase in terms of thin film polyamide composite membranes. Metapyridine is taken or piperazine is taken in water phase, and this acid chloride is in hexane phase. This is the conventional one. But I have just tuned in particular fashion water acetonitrile mixture in terms of water I have taken, and acetonitrile in place of water I have taken. Rejection profile is different. Just see regarding this is I have told you, this is polypiperazinamide, this is nanofiltration membranes. Just see the performances. 95.34, this is for sodium sulfate separation, 95.34%. And your sodium chloride separation is 48.96. That means nearly 50% difference is there in terms of bivalent and monovalent separation. Understand the particular chemistry of these polypiperazinamide membranes. Whatever I have told regarding thin film polyamide composite membranes, two types of membranes are there. One has the selectivity of bivalent and monovalent. Another is no bivalent monovalent selectivity. Here it is showing bivalent monovalent selectivity. And this particular diuron separation is low, 24.61%, and isoproterone also 36.12%. That means it is low of low separation ability membranes. But if you tune this particular interfacial polymerization chemistry by changing your water to water acetonitrile, the rejection profile will be different. Just see, this is 79.34%, and this is isoproterone is coming 90.95%. That means if you can tune your interfacial polymerization chemistry, you can produce different properties into onto the particular membranes. That's the beauty of this particular thin film polyamide composite membranes. For Shourier-Rajan chemistry or Shourier-Rajan, whatever I have told you regarding cellulose acetate membranes, this type of tuning features is not there. You cannot tune in that fashion. That is the basic difference of thin film polyamide composite membranes and cellulose acetate membranes, apart from its differences are there, or limitations of natural polymeric membranes. Anyway, this is the whatever I have shown you regarding membrane preparation and membrane. If you can just change your membranes, your separation ability will be different. And this is the chemistry structural pattern of diuron and isoproterone. Just see, this is phenyl urea herbicides. This is the urea unit. It is called phenyl urea herbicides. This is also phenyl urea herbicides. Difference is there. Here chlorine is there. Here just isopropyl unit is there. Anyway, next slide. Just see another type of example I have just shown you in this particular slides. Just see, this is non-woven polyester fabric, polysulfone and polypiperazinamide. This is the conventional thing, conventional mechanism. What I have done afterwards, some layer I have just coated polyacrylic acid coated membranes over the polypiperazinamide membranes. That means membrane is now different. Membrane 1 and membrane 2 is different. Though polypiperazinamide is there, but layer is different. Here I have just changed the particular sequence of the modified layer. Polyacrylic acid first and then polypiperazinamide. Just see, the difference is there. Just for membrane 1, this is any solute you can take. This is simazine also herbicides. It is used in agriculture, and that it is coming into the particular water, and it just whatever you are drinking, it may have some herbicides because of our country's agricultural economy, or whatever maybe we are using pesticides to produce more products or more corn, vegetables in terms of cattle to people, all the people. Anyway, that is a different story. This is this membrane one is showing 74.8% simazine rejections. Atrazine, it is showing 81.8%. But if you just coated by some layer, it will just increase. It is simazine is 78.9% and atrazine is 88.1% from this 81.8%. And this membrane 3, that means your modified layer is in between. That is showing 87.7%. And this is 96.1%. That means if you change your chemistry in terms of membrane production or whatever may be, that blocking effect will differ from your original membranes or virgin membranes. This is the blocking effect order, membrane 3 greater than membrane 2 greater than membrane 1. Anyway, flux is almost same. I have also written in this first column flux liter meter square per day. In terms of per day, I have, that is also another unit. That means liter meter square hour per hour, and as well as liter meter square per day, you can just express. Anyway, next slide. This is size factor. Just in terms of atrazine and simazine, just see atrazine is showing higher rejection compared to simazine because of higher size. That means atrazine size is much more compared to simazine. That is why it is showing 81.7%, simazine is showing 75.5%. And this is another factor. This is polarity of pesticides. If your solute molecules have the polar nature, it will pass through the membranes, because your membranes, whatever I am discussing in terms of today's lecture, that is negatively charged membranes. That is, it will pass through, that polar molecules will pass through it. That means rejection will be minimum. If polarity is there, that means rejection will be less. Some examples I have given, and this is the two isomers, 2,6-dichlorophenol and 2,4-dichlorophenol. You know that these are the structural isomer I have taken, and this is 2,6-dichlorophenol. It is showing 48.9% rejection. 2,4-dichlorophenol, it is showing 36.9%, because its polarity or dipole moment is different. 2,4-dichlorophenol have the dipole moment of 2.164 dipole, that means it will pass through and rejection is minimum. Similar here also, 2-chlorophenol as well as 4-chlorophenol, that is 2-chlorophenol, it is 0.938 dB, and this 4-chlorophenol, it is 1.477 dB. That means these particular 4-chlorophenol have the and higher dipole moment and rejection will be minimum. And another interesting thing you can see, from pentachlorophenol to phenol, I have covered, that is also chlorophenol series. That means size factor is there. From pentachlorophenol, this is showing 74.2%, and it is decreasing, 60.3%, 48.9%, 36.9%, 33%, 21.2%, and 26.4%. That means if your particular solute, feed solute, is of higher size, it will reject. It is a known fact that size factor is the predominant factor in terms of your separation. But here for organics, apart from size factor, various other factors are also influencing the separation. That is why I am covering in terms of this particular polarity factor here. In terms of isomeric separation, suppose in terms of this is I am telling in terms of water pollutants. Suppose you may be the acquainted with different drugs, some dextra or levo, whatever may be structural isomer, they are of different polarity. One you want to separate from that particular mixture, then membrane separation can be advantageous to separate that type of drug. Okay, next slide. This is another factor, just in terms of catechol and resorcinol I have covered. Catechol resorcinol also isomer, that is just see molecular mass is same, 110.1. molecular volume is also almost same, but this is called partition coefficient. This is actually related to this separation and hydrophobicity. This is catechol having the hydrophobicity, or you can just say this is partition log P factor, that is octanol water phase have given the value 0.88. This is 0.8 for resorcinol. For catechol, just see this is one type of membrane, just whatever may be that I will explain. This sodium chloride separation is 94.3%, and this catechol separation is have 98.7%, but resorcinol rejection is less compared to catechol because of this factor. This is called hydrophobicity. Hydrophobicity is like this. This is log P equals to log C0 by C0 means CO, not C0, CO. That means octanol, and this is water concentration ratio, that is called your partition coefficient. And this C0 and CO and CW are the pesticide concentration in the in octanol and water. And this is the terminology. This is actually log P. You are accustomed to this, those who are regarding chemistry persons, they are acquainted to the particular log P factor. And this is log P factor means higher, means it will reject much more. Why it is like this? Because hydrophobic molecules will be away from membranes. Hydrophilic molecule will be attached to the membranes or pass through the membranes. That is why catechol resorcinol separation is different. Anyway, another example is there regarding here it is whatever I have told you regarding polysulfur membrane. This is polysulfur membrane, this is polyether sulfur membrane. That means it is the derivative of polysulfone. Just see the differences here also. 96.5% rejection of our catechol, and this is resorcinol, it is 84.9% rejection. That means catechol rejection is much more compared to resorcinol. Anyway, next slide. This is influence of pH. Whatever I have told you regarding feed water pH, that is also controlling factor on membrane separation. Membrane performance depends on the pH of the feed solution. Actually, for the polyamide, thin film polyamide composite membrane, the carboxylic acid, I have shown you the carboxylic acid. At low pH, the carboxyl will be carboxyl. That means it will be COOH. But in terms of higher pH, COOH will be ionized in terms of COO minus. That means it will have negatively charged. That is why membrane separation will be different. Other ionizable chemical functionalities, sulfonates, amines also have the ability to influence charge on the membranes. That means you can impart charge onto the membranes by just putting in some chemical functionalities onto it. If you sulfonate it, it will be negatively charged. If you just addition of quaternary ammonium salts, it will be of positively charged. Anyway, next slide. This is my recent publications regarding this pesticide separation. this pesticide is a hexaconazole, and hexaconazole have separated in different membranes. What's the beauty of this particular membranes? I have incorporated copper ion onto the particular membranes. That is the basic chemistry I have brought into the particular paper. That PIP and TMC, just see, membrane one is PIP and TMC, that means polypyrazinamide membranes, that is made up of piperazine as well as trimethyl chloride. Membrane two is piperazinamide, copper two, and TMC. And membrane three is copper two, PIP, and TMC. Chemistry is like this. Suppose whatever I have shown you, membrane 2, if you add your PIP onto the membranes and after that copper 2 you are adding, then chemistry is different from membrane 3. First, copper is added onto the membranes and then PIP is added. That means chemistry of the particular interfacial polymerization will be different from membrane 1 to membrane 3. What for copper ion I have taken here for this particular study? Actually, these membranes have the limitations of bacterial fouling. Bacterial fouling means in your feed matrix, if bacteria is there, then it can foul and it will disturb your membrane separation as well as its life. That is why if something is there, metal ion is there, or whatever you are acquainted with, particular advertisement or whatever, toothpaste or something like that, silver ion is incorporated for bactericidal property. Here I have imported copper, not silver ion chosen, because copper ion, if copper can click, then it will be less expensive in terms of your membrane cost. That is why copper ion incorporated membranes I have prepared in this particular study. Here this is the chemistry, same chemistry I have written here also, but copper ion incorporation is there. This is the rejection profile. Just see, this is nearly 90% rejections, but membrane 1 to membrane 3, its performances are different. Membrane 3 is showing highest rejection in terms of hexaconazole. Hexaconazole, that means another water pollutant is there. It has some size, and that is why if your particular membranes of higher pore size, it will have less rejection compared to this particular membrane 3. Membrane 3 is the best one. That means copper 2 first and then afterwards PIP and TMC. Anyway, this is the different feed matrices we have used regarding filled water, tap water, and deionized water. Membrane separation is also varying. Just if your feed matrix is different, that means if your lab study is based on distilled water, its separation is one. And if you change your feed matrix in terms of filled water, your rejection profile or separation profile will be different, because in filled water natural organic matter is there. We have analyzed that, but whatever may be, but I am not written or I am mentioning here. Anyway, this is the I have told you why I have targeted in terms of these particular applications. Copper ion incorporation membranes. This is, I am showing microvalve count. Just see, this is membrane 2 is showing antibacterial property much more than membrane 1, and membrane 3 is somewhat showing better compared to this, but it is showing higher compared to membrane 2. Anyway, next slide. This is regarding whatever I have mentioned you regarding additives. If you add something into the particular feed matrices, your rejection profile will be different. Just see, this is the schematic diagram of this membrane separation. One is hydrophobic solute, that means whatever may be organic solute are just taken in terms of water pollutants or drugs, whatever may be. And this is the, it is passing through the membranes. But if you add something, that means here we are adding some surfactant, it will form micelle onto the particular feed matrix. That means your particular organics will be embedded into the particular surfactants. Then your effective size of the solutes will be much more compared to your originally hydrophobic solutes. That means your sieving factors you can change. That is why rejection will be much more compared to this. That is the beauty of this surfactant added. It is called surfactant enhanced separation. And your this thing, ultrafiltration also can serve the purpose. That means if you take reverse osmosis membranes, your pressure is needed much more compared to ultrafiltration membranes. But if you add some surfactant and effectively the size will be much more, then your sieving you can control and you can take your ultrafiltration membranes in terms of reverse osmosis. That is energy saving trick. This is in terms of surfactant. This is pentachlorophenol, simazine, and these are the surfactant I have used in terms of sodium dodecyl sulfate, cetyl trimethyl ammonium bromide. And result is, I have shown you some glimpses. Next slide. And this is the just particular whatever may be some observations in terms of surfactant separation. Suppose in terms of pentachlorophenol, if you add sodium dodecyl sulfate, just see without sodium dodecyl sulfate, it is showing nearly 37% rejection. But if you add sodium dodecyl sulfate, it will increase its rejection ability. And this is the beauty of these particular membranes in terms of surfactant enhanced membranes, surfactant enhanced filtration. This is one of the techniques by which you can separate so many things, not only in terms of water pollutants, you can do whatever you like in terms of metal ions, in terms of your this thing, drugs and everything. But problem is that your surfactant should be safe, so that if it is used in drinking water, then it should separate 99% more, 99% rejection have a surfactant rejection will be safe for your this drinking water. This I have shown again. This is regarding two surfactants. This is black one is sodium dodecyl sulfate. It increases the rejection, and this cetyl tertiary ammonium bromide, it just shows not positive effect compared to this sodium dodecyl sulfate. That means nature of surfactant is also a particular controlling factor in terms of rejection ability in terms of membranes. Anyway, the next slide. Just see, this is the more clear picture you can get. This atrazine separation, Jesse, this is SLS, that means sodium lauryl sulfate anionic surfactant it is used, and this is two different membranes I have taken, no problem, just for your understanding. Just see, in terms of SLS, if we add SLS from 0 to this up to 200 mg per liter, I have added, it increases separation. It started from this 50 and it is above 65 or something like that. And this is CTAL, that means this is cationic surfactant. SLS is anionic surfactant. CTAB is cationic surfactant. Just see, cationic surfactant, if we add something into particular feed matrix in terms of atrazine, then its rejection profile will be this. It is somewhat decreasing. But if we add Triton X 100, that is neutral surfactant, it deteriorates separation. That means surfactant nature also can play the role. If you add, suppose whatever you are seeing in terms of atrazine, if you add surfactant Triton X, it will give negative result compared to your SLS. This is the particular technique one can follow regarding this particular in terms of energy saving direction, in terms of membranes. Anyway, I think I've covered. Next slide. Yes, thank you for your listening. If you have any question, I can just I will try to answer that regarding in terms of membranes.
By the time our viewers come out with questions, let me play the role of a layman with not much initiative into this, Dr. Bhattacharya, and ask you a few questions on my own. One thing I'd like to know is the membrane separation techniques that.
Your sound is not clear.
Is it clear now?
Now it's clear. Okay.
Yes. What I said is, before our visitors and viewers put forward their questions, I would like to play the role of a layman and ask a few questions to you, who is not initiated into this field of membrane separation at all. Well, from your presentation, what I gather is probably from now on, our viewers and our visitors, they will not only be aware about the fact that membrane separation is possible for water purification, but they would also like to have a technical analysis of the rejection profile of the membranes they are going to use. I'd like to know about the condition of your field. How much it is prevalent in the commercial market to use the membrane separation nowadays? Is it a very common device in your sense?
Yes, yes. Just before coming to question, my message is there regarding whatever our understanding regarding AquaGuard or whatever we are using in terms of household. Just I am expressing my views in particular in that aspect. regarding RO water filtration unit, I think for corporation water it is not needed. This is the basic thing why I am uttering these words, because corporation water is already treated, no need to use these particular RO membranes. You can use your ultra filtration membranes. Those who are supplying these particular RO kit, you can ask the question whether it is ultra filtration membranes or RO membranes. RO membranes we don't want. Ultra filtration membranes for bacterial removal, it's okay. That is required, you know, for our corporation water. But in terms of their marketing, they are hiding something. If something they don't want to explain, or they are not aware, the marketing professionals, they are not aware of that particular thing. All of that particular feed quality doesn't require these particular RO filtration kit. In terms of corporation water, I am telling. Ultra filtration, it's okay, but not needed in terms of RO. RO is pressure driven technique, high pressure driven technique, and this particular thing is required for desalination of water or something, water pollutant separation, whatever I have shown you regarding this particular thing. But for bacterial removal or whatever may be in terms of household, it is required ultra filtration and serve the purpose.
That's a very good insight. I think it is a very practical and useful insight that all the people will be very much benefited from.
Another thing, I just want to add this thing. Just before setting up any household kit, you need to just analyze your feed water quality, whether it is required or not.
But what sort of analysis, and where can you get that?
It is analysis is important because of whether your salinity is there or not. Suppose 500 above 500 TDS, it's problematic for household. But if it is below 500, no need to do desalination, no need to do other things. Only thing is required, only ultrafiltration membranes, just for bacterial remover or particle separation, whatever you can do by active carbon filtration and something like that. No need to go something like that, different RO kits and something they are setting in terms of their profit business.
So that is you feel that you could be overkill.
Yes.
The overkill is absolutely not required. Okay, that's fine. That's a very, very, very important issue. Now, I have another question that from my experience with water, we found that the water usage in our country is maximum towards the agricultural production.
Yes.
And when we go for agricultural production, the water that comes out of it is definitely very much rich in pesticides and all. Yes. Are you suggesting that by following these membrane separation methods, this pesticide-laden water can once again be reclaimed and be used for other purposes? Is it possible to take them to the potable water level?
Yes. No problem. Just regarding my experimental analysis, I have one collaboration regarding Kollani Agricultural University. They have analyzed, they have mixed pesticides, 42 pesticides they have mixed in, and they have just passed through our membranes, and it has excellent separation capability. That means, whatever I have shown, this is model system, single system, or whatever maybe in terms of chemistry I have given, but in terms of actual field water, And there may be mixture of pesticides. There may be different organics are maybe there. That is why membrane separation is only the options to reclaim the water.
That is a very good news, in fact, because it is the largest source of unusability of water through agriculture. So yes, probably if it is possible. But is it prevalent in our country right now? Is there any practice?
No. In our country, it is not practiced. Actually, whatever we are operating in terms of brackish water desalination as well as seawater desalination, in terms of agricultural pesticide separation, no commercial unit is there. But we can just take initiative in terms of organic pollutant separation. Every industry has its particular plant in terms of reclaim the water that is not for drinking water, that is for different purpose. But in terms of whatever, in terms of village or whatever maybe, we can suggest that in terms of,
I mean, wherever there is water scarcity, probably the agriculture water can once again be recycled.
Yes.
If it is possible and if the technology is available so easily with you people and your institution, then what do you feel? Why is not there a common practice of using it? Is it the unawareness? Is it the lack of awareness, or is there any other?
Yes. It is the lack of awareness. But we have installed a plant in terms of pesticide separation in Punjab. This is, I think, Central University of Punjab. We have installed one plant regarding this pesticide separation. Punjab has the problem in terms of pesticides in water, and toxic effects are also prevalent in this particular state, apart from its other problems that is also there. But in terms of agricultural economy, they are suffering.
I have another interest. I know that arsenic contamination is a huge problem all over our country in water. Now, can the membrane technology help in that field as well?
Just I want to. I have. You can. Whether you can show a second slides, I think.
Sure. Just a minute, it's coming.
Third.
Go to the third one, please.
Jesse, central part. This is resin. This is arsenic selective resin.
Okay.
This is the commercial means not large plant. I have added here.
I'm pointing out here. Is it the one? You can see the cursor. Is it the one?
This one. Yes. Central, yellow mark is there, just that is resin.
Yes,
this is arsenic selective resin. It will absorb arsenic, and this is the particular plant we have installed in Bashirhat and Maslanpur. I have initiated in this particular mission. I have initially 10 household. I have installed this plant, and after that, they have just taken it to Bashirhat. 60 plants they have installed in different locations. This is not based on, this is not based on membrane. This is called adsorbent. This is arsenic selective resin. We are also dealing with this particular effort from our membrane activities. Another activities are also there, arsenic selective resin that we are preparing, and we can install this de-arsenification plant. Regarding your questions, whatever you are telling, arsenic, whether arsenic can be rejected by membranes or not. Of course, arsenic is a negatively charged species and it can separate arsenic. That is not a problem, but community scale is important, because membrane, apart from these arsenic selective resin, it is cost effective. But if you take this membrane module or something like that, it will be expensive. For just regarding arsenic, Moslandapur and Boshirhat, just you can think of below poverty line, many families are there. They cannot afford these membrane-based technology. That is why we have catered this particular de-arsenification plant in terms of arsenic selective resin.
Well, that's a very good news, and probably the cost will also come down so that it would be available for more and more people. Now, in your presentation, you talked about handcrafting polymer membranes in some place. What I'd like to know is that is it possible to develop such membrane-based filtering systems for a local community, or they have to go to some expert all the time or to some commercial house all the time?
No, no. Actually, very interesting questions you have asked in terms of expertise. Actually, membrane preparation is an art. That means general public cannot particular prepare membranes. Whatever I have shown you regarding hand casting, it may be simple, but thousands hand casting I have done, and after that I have the expertise. That is particular thing. Otherwise, if you think in terms of availability of chemicals, it's okay, no problem. It's required only organic solvent and polymer, and water is there. That means no problem. Only expertise should be there.
Why I ask you the question about is this, because I have my small interest as well, that if you think it is very easily can be adopted by some persons through practice and by acquiring certain skills, and if it is useful that way, then whether we can think of a collaboration where you give the knowledge know-how and we make a provision for getting people trained into this technology so that they can make it more useful. Whether that's a possibility or not, that I was trying to explain.
That we can think of. That you can think of. And whatever you are just discussing, I think you can think of in different way. Suppose bacterial filtration is required for any damage or something like that. Whatever I have shown you, these type of apparatus, drain and filtration apparatus, just they can prepare. It is also a simple one, no problem to prepare this, and after that they can prepare the membranes and they can install this particular unit in their household.
So here itself I propose you to have one workshop where we can develop this one. Let's begin with this and let us carry it forward if it is possible to make it more wide scale.
Yes, that's for ultrafiltration membranes, but in terms of desalination, other things.
No, naturally, whatever is possible, and if it is possible to have bacterial filtration so easily, then I think it might be a household phenomenon even.
That is good.
Okay, I don't find any question as of now here, and not much in our Facebook or YouTube forum as well. So I played the role of the people to ask and pose certain questions. But it was a wonderful time, and thank you very much for allowing us to take so much of your time from your research and other activities.
Thank you for inviting me. I have given some messages regarding this lecture. One is this World Water Day, and regarding this particular presentation, I have not prepared in that way. But message should relay to the society, save water, and so that our next generation can have the availability of this particular fresh water. Otherwise, it is very difficult to just manage everything. Whatever we are experienced in this particular area regarding summertime, it's regarding fresh water, it's really problematic. And rather than fresh water, you can get Coca-Cola or something like that. That is very problematic for Gujarat and other things in Maharashtra or something in Rajasthan area. That you are acquainted with particular area, but I am experiencing in this particular location in Saurashtra region.
The Rajasthan area also. In fact, the understanding is in a decade or so, a large part of India will be water stressed.
Yes.
Not under water scarcity, definitely it would be water stressed. So yes, water reclaiming is going to be a very important technology in coming days. And since you initiated this and took the name of this Coca-Cola, I have just one curious question for you. Is it possible to revert the Coca-Cola into pure water again?
That is not a problem.
By using numbers?
Coca-Cola means only sugar solutions.
Okay. Okay. It is possible to separate out very easily.
Yes.
And is it possible to extend it to the level that where environmental threats of water spills are huge? Is it possible to separate out water spills and reclaim the water again?
Actually, whether it will be cost effective or not, that we have to see.
That may be another.
Otherwise, in terms of technology, it's okay. No problem.
It is possible. The viability is the question. But is there any such research to find out whether what oil spill separation is also possible to do?
Yes. That is also membrane area. Actually, whatever you are just pointing, it's a very big area. Actually, oil, water, oil in water, and water in oil. Two other factors, two other areas. What you want to do? Suppose one of the my research orientation is hydrolase type of enzyme immobilization onto the particular membranes. That means if you add or immobilize some hydrolase type of enzyme onto the particular membranes, the membranes will hydrolyze its olive water. My direction was olive oil water separations or hydrolyze. That is water in oil. That means percentage of olive oil is less, and you can hydrolyze that by enzymatic hydrolysis.
Okay.
That is one area.
But this, is it also possible to extend this to mineral oil mixtures?
Yes. That is also just particular research is going on in this particular field. Just I am uttering.
Yes, please. You are saying something.
Just whatever you have told, na, just in terms of oil in water and water in oil, that problem is there. In terms of where oil water mixture, oil is much more. Your membrane should be like this. It will be oleophobic.
Right.
So that it can separate, it can sustain the particular system.
Right. Very much true. And one final question that I'd like to put forward to you today, and after that we'll close up this session, is as a research field, how much you'd encourage the youngsters to join this field with their prospect to adopt as a profession? Do you think that for the young budding chemists, this is a very burgeoning area where they can do well and which can be beneficial to the society very much?
Yes. I actually fond of, initially I was in the particular domain in terms of this particular basic science. You know that. And after that, when I dipped into the particular applied chemistry or applied science, I think it has huge potential. You can think of, you can cater so many people, and you can just bring smile to them. That is my field experience. Whatever I am telling regarding Ayla, and just I have shown you the one photo regarding that deer sanification or something like that. I have the experience in terms of their just water, safe water or something like that. Government vehicle is there, and they are supplying some water. They are taking it as just gold, God gift. Well, just they have asked whether it is safe. I have just drink in there, just in front of them. Just this is safe. It's different. Different experience. Yeah, I cannot express that particular whatever feeling we are just have. And in that particular season, it just in terms of Ayla, I think 2014 something like that. That time I have just that mobile van from Gujarat to this your Hingalganj, Sundarban. There we have installed this particular mobile van, and we have produced 24 hours per day. That is after that UNICEF they have delivered them in video office jerrycan. So many, 1 lakh jerrycans were there. They have just taken, and they have just taken it to the particular boat, and they have supplied different islands. That is a different experience. I cannot express that particular thing.
It's wonderful to know that science is being of help to people to that scale and to that extent. And our best wishes for you for continuing all these works. For today, we have taken quite a long time from you, and we have also engaged our viewers for quite a long time. So I think today we'll stop here, but we'll look forward to further collaborations so that we can carry on these projects for the people even more. Okay?
Thank you.
Seeing you and talking to you after so many days. So let us end with a virtual embrace here, with the hope that we'll sometimes very soon meet once again in person.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you.
Okay.